on BBC Two, I was two and my only interest would have been in drinking and dribbling. No change there then. So how old were you and what were you up to in 1974?
Rhubarb! They're here!
Oh no, tell them to come back in 40 seconds. Welcome to I Love 1974, the year I got my own show. The year of bionic beauties, funny food, jungle japes, flurries of fists, delectable dancers, furious flatulence.
Let's get on with it then.
As it happens, it's Top of the Pops.
The charts in 74 were regularly topped by acts which harked back to the 1950s, and the group with the best-selling single of the year were no exception.
Was it Shawaddy Waddy? No, Mud.
Mud were always cod, if there is such a phrase. They were cod and they knew it.
Wonderful thing about Mud. You look at Les Gray, and you just look at the twinkle in his eyes saying, can you believe the money I'm making for doing this? It's fantastic, isn't it? And he sort of thought, yeah, good on you, Les.
Nobody took it too serious, I hope.
Playing a lot of social clubs, mining villages and stuff, we'd see these rockers with the old sweatback hair, greased hair and stuff.
You know, people doing all this fist dancing, the shoulder dance and everything else at gigs. And we thought, So then when we came to do the TV, we worked that into the thing. We used the roadies. They learnt the dance and they came and they did it on Top of the Pops with us, you know. And then we got phone calls then from Holland saying, oh, you must bring the roadies. So we had to fly all the flipping roadies to Holland to do a TV show. They even got their own photographs and were handing out their own signed photographs in the end.
Those looked quite violent to me. I think it was probably a dance that blokes could do that didn't suggest they were homosexual.
Some of these wardrobe guys came in and said, you would look lovely with these dangly earrings. And everybody went, wow, you got to do that. And I thought, oh, no, I feel like a prat, really. You know? But I did it, and it just got more outrageous and more outrageous by each record. Even the record company didn't want it let out that I had a girlfriend and stuff, you know. Like, don't let anybody know you're not gay, you know.
We used to attract the most peculiar people, from like big fat girls in green, long green leather coats and clumpy shoes and chewing gum, white lipstick, to like rock and rollers and greasers, you know, guys would turn up like covered in chains and studs and back, yeah, trick, you know, and there'd still be little kids, you know, of like 9 or 10.
Do you think success has changed you as a person?
Don't think so. I don't want to become all that, you know, a big flashy. Don't want to be like that. I'm not Emma Vale.
I don't think you are, no.
That's
you.
Right then.
You're really nice and real and natural. It's lovely. It'll be lonely this Christmas
without you to hold. At that time, you had to mime on television. Now that's fine, singing. But I challenge anybody to try and mime talking.
And I remember looking at you then. And I remember thinking, Christmas must have been made for us.
Impossible.
Because, darling, this is the time of year that you really need love.
We try to make it humorous, you know, but tongue-in-cheek, you know, without being like a comedy band, you know. And the only way to do that is send yourself up. This Christmas.
Merry Christmas, darling, wherever you are.
74's top-selling solo artist was even more of a retro rocker.
Alvin Stardust. Alvin Stardust, just take a look at it. What a weird idea. He was clearly 60 years of age. He was like an aging teddy boy dressed by Ann Summers. And he had the black leather glove. Very, very scary indeed. Come on, let's go to my flat. Lay down
and groove on the mat. We can be cool. I thought, I've got to be different, otherwise I won't stand out. So I went out and bought some black leathers and a black jacket and the black gloves, and I dyed my hair black. I woke up the next morning, I had blue streaks down the side of my face like this with a dye run, and I didn't know what to do. Grand director inquiries quickly, or looked in yellow pages, and I said, excuse me, is any, do you do sideboards ready-made? I thought, if I could stick some sideboards on. So I went round, they fitted me up to match this jet black hair I'd just done with these jet black sideboards, and I stuck them on. I turned up at the BBC TV centre and did Top of the Pops. And from there on in, I had to wear these sideboards.
74, a great year for Alvin Stardust. He's here on Top of the Pops with his Jealous Mind.
Why is it I must know the things you do here? It's just my jealous mind.
There was a kind of mean and moody, untouchable thing. Instead of holding the mic like that, I kind of held it sideways, and I suppose a little bit of Gene Vincent in there, where he used to kind of look up at the ceiling, and instead of looking up in the air, I tended to look straight into the lens of the camera and point.
Really scary. Some people hid behind the settee from the Daleks. I hid behind the settee from Alvin Stardust.
Hey, you must be out of your tiny minds. When you cross the road, always use the green cross code. Keep your wits about you and keep looking and listening. Great. See you, girls. Take it from me. Be smart. Be safe.
I really don't think it was a good lesson for young girls, was it? Do you think this scurry elderly man in leather, possibly with a prosthetic arm, singing sotto voce, these lyrics with a deeply strange sexual undercurrent? Girl dancing in the red dress. Don't hear them, and don't play any of it on this show in case small children are listening. I'm not your brother, you're not my sister.
Lord above, you're a girl and I'm a mister. Things come to an end there. Uh-oh. Thank you very much for being our guest.
I was enjoying it.
Very interesting. I've learned a lot more about the pop scene, and I'm sure our audience has too. And I love him.
He's a walking miracle. Remember, the Bionic Man.
And the Bionic Woman!
We have separation. Inboard, outboard, they're on.
Steve Austin is an astronaut, and he has an accident, and he goes, I can't hold it, Oscar, I'm breaking off.
Flight calm, I can't hold it, she's breaking up, she's breaking.
And then the rocket thing goes along this runway and explodes, and then switch to operating theater with little square plastic compartment off leg open with electronic wires and tweezers and things going in.
Gentlemen, we can rebuild him.
We have the technology. That was the famous one.
We have the technology. We can make him faster. Cut to Lee in tracksuit running on treadmill. And it becomes the Bionic Man. And basically he just never gets a day's peace from that moment on. From that day forward, he's eternally grateful to Oscar Goldman, and he has to just constantly go on missions.
You know Oscar, he's always finding something for me to do.
It was just a huge, huge hit, straight away. We were on Friday night. And then on Monday, my daughters were in school. And in the afternoon, I got a call from one of them.
Dad, everybody's running around in slow motion. I said, really? I didn't say anything to her, but I thought, well, I might be around for a while.
People forget that only, well, how many years has it been? 25? 25 years ago when we were filming this show, that the technology in the film business was so nominal. Today, my kids laugh at it.
This is Oscar Goldman. I want this building sealed immediately.
At the time, we were in what was called the Cold War, and we couldn't send troops in like you did when you go to war. So this was an opportunity to just send one person in on a job to either bring out someone, to get information. It really was CIA stuff.
You're a government agent?
That's right. The only way to avoid an international incident is for me to get back what's inside that embassy museum.
Lee was a limited actor, and he knew that.
What do you mean?
Acted like he was constipated all the time. You know, I mean, he'd sort of talk like that. Kenny, how you doing? You know, it's like there was some gas pains going on there.
I guess you're right.
Well, he's a ladies' man, you know, and I thought that was attractive at a young age.
Do you get up to Aspen very often?
I try to get up as often as possible.
Yeah, he was good-looking at the time, and his clothes seemed really excellent at the time, and he seemed quite relaxed and cool. Let me tell you about him, can't do without him. He's one of a kind, now he's the man. Now he's the man.
The idea came up that we should have a love interest for him.
Hey, sweetheart.
They designed a character that had gone to school with Steve Austin, high school sweethearts, I guess.
Oh, boy, I'm so glad to see you.
Marry me?
I thought you'd never ask that.
Jamie! Oscar, I asked you up here to help me. And you have the power to put her back together again just like you did me.
And she rejected the bionics and died.
Oh, dear God.
When I had written the script, I had originally conceived of leaving Jamie in some sort of cryogenic deep freeze because I thought, well, you know, you might want to resurrect her. And Frank Price, who was running Universal at the time, said, no, Ken, we want to do Love Story. And Love Story is very big. We want her. We don't want a lot of bionic people running around. And you kill her off. We want her dead. Okay.
So they got rid of her.
Sweet Jamie, I'll love you forever.
The public reaction to Jamie Summers dying was astronomical. I mean, it shocked us all.
It just went through the roof.
They were trying to bring this thing back.
But they kept saying, what about her? She's dead.
Well, maybe we should bring her back. Who killed her off anyway? Why'd you do that, Kenny? You know, so bring her back to life. Oh, sure, okay.
To Steve Austin and the world, Jamie was dead. But was she?
Cryogenics brought her back to life.
I thought she was a cracking piece of stuff when I was about 12, like, yeah. And she was all bionic as well, so she'd probably be up to the job as well.
Can you just rephrase that?
Sorry about that.
As a human being, she can't think for herself.
Since when is thinking for herself an asset in a woman?
A secret message for Jamie Summers.
I'll get the code book from her bionic mission purse.
It's the bionic woman Jamie Summers with her new bionic mission purse.
I never thought I'd become a doll.
Red boiler suit, I remember, and
the bionic eye, which is, of course, brilliant. Just to be part of that smile of someone's... And then the roll-up arm, of course, he had the skin, which rolled back horribly like a condom or something. He's a walking miracle.
I wonder what Lee Majors is doing now.
Well,
Lee Majors, $6 million man. Mary Cunningham, $1.8 million lotto winner.
I bet you don't have your own action figure. No, 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 no.
And it feels like 1974.
Up until the 70s, really, there wasn't such a thing as instant food.
Slice the soup and noodles, yeah, like soup and noodles.
Just drop the noodles in boiling water, add the flavour packet, stir and simmer for 4 minutes.
It's not surprising that, you know, in the era that saw the public fascinated with other quick fixes, like, you know, the bionic woman and the $6 million man, that same sort of ethos should appear on the table. And that we should expect, you know, bionic dinners, which would taste delicious, but involve absolutely no work at all.
Kellogg's Super Noodles add a new twist to mealtime.
So there were products like Smash.
For mash, get
Smash.
Virtually instant mashed potatoes, allegedly indistinguishable from ones that were produced by, you know, half hours of slaving over a hot stove.
They are clearly the most primitive people.
It was a time when you used to do lots of Angel Delight, which was, you know, add the milk and whick it up. And
started to foam up. It was something like what came out of the Daleks' heads.
And there you go. You've got your dessert.
It's the very best of summer to be in the sun and dream a little. And enjoy the freshness and lightness. Bird's Angel Delight recaptures a cool flavor like summer fruit and country cream in a taste that's the very best of summer.
There were quite a lot of dehydrated foods on the market.
Probably once a week we used to get Vesta Chow Mein.
Chow Mein. Somehow it couldn't have been thought of anywhere else.
Still sometimes buy Vesta Chow Mein just as kind of act of solidarity with the People's Republic of Vesta and their downtrodden workers.
Oriental, mysterious, exciting, imaginative. That's the extra you get in a Vesta Chow Mein.
You inevitably used to get dry bits that hadn't... there would be like sort of pockets of powder in there somewhere.
There was all these reconstituted bits of soya and sort of faux carrot.
That's why when you give them a Vesta meal, you give them something extra. But you don't pay extra for it.
To a child of Lancashire in the mid-70s, they were, I felt like Egon Roney. You know, it was a party in a box waiting to happen.
But it tasted like the box.
Show them. You're a slim see girl. You're a slim girl.
John calls me his new wife now. No wonder. Look at me as his old one. And I didn't give up bread.
Fueled by the idea that technology could provide a quick fix, there was a growing sense that one could also combine indulgence with a lack of consequence.
Show them you're a slimsia girl, a slimsia girl.
The reason that they didn't have any calories, because they didn't have anything in them. They didn't have any bread in them at all. You know, if you sort of weren't sharpish, taking them out of the packet, they floated away.
When you were hungry, you used to get the nimble, you used to roll it up into a ball and shove it in your mouth. It was a tiny ball like this. There's nothing in there.
There were really all those breads that food scientists like Margaret Thatcher had helped to create in the 60s, weren't they? Which was something like 1% bread and 98% compressed air, I think.
Slimming magazine approves Nimble as part of your calorie control diet because Nimble is real bread but lighter.
In the world of boxing, 1974 was a great year for Muhammad Ali. He beat Joe Frazier, then rumbled in the jungle with George Foreman to regain his heavyweight crown. But closer to home, another charismatic young fighter was ready to conquer the world.
Is it true that you mean you don't have sex before a fight?
Truth.
No, it's during a fight.
He was like the man. He was almost as near as we got to like a really sort of glamorous American boxer.
John was sharp and witty, and he came from Kirby, and he never let you forget it. And his Liverpudlian wit and style and everything were terrific.
I'm supposed to be the prettiest fighter in the world, and you're prettier than me, and I gotta bump you off.
I'm the champ. I'm the real champ. I will beat the bum. I'm so pretty. He's ugly. I'm the fastest.
So here was a young man, very good looking, and a very able boxer, and was in line for the world title. And everybody hoped he'd win it.
Most fighters won and lost on the training ground. So I used to substitute the training ground for the fighter. I used to give her everything, you know.
He was a hard trainer. He trained well. And he did hard work over the hills. Ice cold, even in winter, he just used to plunge into the lake at the end of his training. And he had a very Spartan regime at that time.
I'm in fantastic shape, you know, better than I've ever been for any previous fights, because this is for the big one, this is for the world title, this is what I've been working for ever since I was a kid.
He had a tough opponent, and it was generally felt, I think, at the time, that perhaps John Conte was just a bit too inexperienced. He hadn't had all that many professional fights, he was only 23.
This is one of the most electric nights in British boxing for many years. This title has only been won twice by British fighters in the whole history of the light heavyweight championship.
He was a tough fighter, and I wasn't going to knock him out. So I knew it was going to go the distance, and that suited me.
Because that night, he must have had 10,000 people on his side, and sitting there ringside, it was like electric.
If I was going, it meant that he was going. And he wasn't going, so I wasn't going. You're thinking, well, when's this going to be over?
And 10,000 people at Wembley sense it. And now all they want to do is to roar Conte home to victory, which surely now must be his.
It's like excitement, you know, waiting for Christmas in the morning. You can't wait for the morning to open your prezzies, like, you know. That's if you're getting any, like, you know. And, well, I was getting one here.
This place will go wild in just a few seconds.
The world's a big place, you know, and just for someone to think that you're champion of the whole planet Earth, like, you know, is something really to sit down and think about and let it sink in, you know.
It was probably the best performance he ever displayed in the ring. Nothing ever after that was quite as good.
John Conte.
I had to walk down and I had to hit this particular spot, you know. And I couldn't do it. I was going down, I was trying to get the right movement on. Hit the spot, and I was thinking, hit the spot, get the walk, get the in the note and all the rest. Eventually, I got all that. You know, I got the movement, I got the walk, I got the tempo and everything. Hit the spot, and they opened them out, and then I forgot I couldn't sing. But I don't let the evening get me down. I think it was the band, they weren't in tune. They couldn't keep up with me.
John being John, never did anything by halves, and he began to develop a very lurid taste for the nightlife. And there were lots of incidents, which he laughs about today, but they really were, in their way, tragic. There was one famous night when he got into his white Rolls Royce, when he shouldn't have done, and then tried to steer it down Jermyn Street, which is a narrow street at the best of times, and there were cars parked both sides, I suppose. And on his way down Jermyn Street, he knocked out about 9 other cars.
Bing, bing, bing.
Ping, pong, beep, beep. It was like seeing through a portal to another galaxy. It was like everyone I remember would have tiny moon-faced children wide-eyed in front of it, because it was like, wow, this is the future. We will be going around on hover jetpacks eating protein pill food next week.
To have something that was actually on the telly that you controlled seemed incredibly exotic.
like Pong? Oh, because it helped. Because it was a bit like ping pong. Can we cut that bit?
In the UK, they said, well, I'm sorry, we couldn't really quite put this out in public with that name on it. I said, well, why not? He said, well, pong means a bad smell. You really wouldn't want to have a machine in a bar and have it written fart on it, would you?
Ba-ding, ba-ding. Paul's quick. Oh, what a good save by the goalie. I've got it! Oh, another one from Paul. You'd like the Remember You're a Womble album. OK, next goal. Ready, Tina? One, two, three.
The graphics were so horrible in those days, so we had no capability of making them look good.
The alternative being what? This was cutting edge. This was as good as it got.
Yes. You have a control here, which you can move up and down, which moves your bat.
I see. That's okay. My tennis racket.
I asked for a pong, yes, and Bamta said, yeah, OK. And this thing that I actually eventually got looked like it was smuggled out of Czechoslovakia. It was the size of a fridge freezer. It was an enormous thing. And it was brown, and there was no sound, and there was no score. And that was it.
If you just press that button, the ball comes. That's it.
Oh, I missed. I'm not very good at this.
This sounds terribly toe-curlingly naff, but I've never had more exciting. If there's been a better game invented, I certainly haven't played it. And I used to sit for 2 and 3 hours playing this, and I was gripped. I was absolutely gripped, and I couldn't believe I had such a thing in my own home.
Go.
Right.
Oh, hey, just a minute.
Got through.
Oh, cut here. Hang on. Wait a minute.
And just going on display in shops now is another TV toy, the video cassette tape recorder. It can be used at the press of a button for recording any intriguing program for later replay. You can use it for recording programs while you're out for the evening by the use of a simple time switch. And it can record BBC Two while you're looking at BBC One.
Meet the gang, cause the boys are here, the boys to entertain you with music and laughter.
Squadge out!
It Ate Half Hot Mum came from the same stable as Dad's Army and was another tale of military misfits. At its peak, it was watched by 17 million viewers.
Now the sun is no longer in my eyes, I can see you proper. And a bunch of puffs you is.
They were characters, each one. So you were smiling before they opened their mouths because you knew them so well.
What do you think you're doing, lovely boys? Standing round here drinking tea.
Well, you shut up!
When Windsor Davis shouted "Shut up!", people used to say to me, "Was that very loud?"
Shut up!
Well, you see.
Shut up!
Terribly sorry, sir.
Shut up!
Yeah.
Shut up.
But he hated the concert party mainly because he was homophobic. Didn't like to see his boys dressing up in girls' clothes.
Excuse me, madam. I didn't know there was ladies present. May I inquire your name?
It's me.
My character, Gloria, how do you describe him? Well, he was very theatrical.
Yeah, Gloria, where have you been? I can't find my red knickers anywhere!
Newspapers mostly, you know, used to say, are you a bit like that, Melvin? And I said, no, I'm quite a lot like that. No.
Look at my hands, look at them. Yeah, they're covered in colour. I'm an artist, I'm a highly sensitive dog.
The one thing it should have won an award for, that series, was the atmosphere they created on that set of heat. I mean, you did feel it was hot and it was burning.
I'm sweating like a pig.
That was the downside. We had to have this glycerin put on us to make us look sweaty, and it was sticky, horrible stuff.
Oh, gosh, it's hot, isn't it?
Now, what they're needing is one nice cup of tea.
Before every shot, on the face and under the arms, and as we did a lot of the filming in October, November, it was freezing.
One of these days, I'll get you posted up that jungle so fast your feet won't touch the ground!
I could watch it today and laugh, just laugh. That's what it's all about, isn't it? That kind of programme.
Stop! Let me give you one illustration. Now take the B.
O! B-O-Y-S, boys to entertain.
I can't hear that note. I never could.
Yeah!
And
Remember package holidays in the sun?
Nobody went on holiday in the 60s and suddenly...
People who actually travelled in the 70s were the ordinary families, which had probably never travelled before.
We used to pack the planes full of 119 people and off we'd go to Spain. And compared to nowadays, it was just so basic. We had a box with a biscuit and a cup. Yeah. And passengers used to go, oh, look, yeah. A custard cream. Yeah. You know, they were over the moon. Yeah.
Do you remember what it's like to wake up in the morning with the sun on your face? Do you remember what it's like to dance all night? That's what taking a holiday in Spain's all about. And let's face it, this year, more than ever, you need to get away to Spain.
And one day, this lady was asked if she wanted tea or coffee, and she said tea. So the woman held her cup gingerly like this and expected the tea to come down from the ceiling. But that's the way it was. She didn't know. It yeah, might very well have come down from the ceiling. Yeah. And that awful song.
Oh, this year I'm up the sun is dead.
Plays on, we dance under the stars. Everyone has a good time. The evening to remember, on a holiday, all the family will remember.
When they came back from Spain, they would be pink.
Orange or red.
Like red lobsters, most of them.
And there was always that dreadful smell, you know, when they all got on the aircraft. That awful smell of, I suppose,
sweat.
Sun And they always got onto the flight with enormous, great big donkeys.
Masses of donkeys.
And they all thought they were terribly individual, these 119 donkeys.
Beautiful, yeah. Go on, what about that for a little bit of ole? That, of course, is Silvia and Eviva España.
And it feels like 1974.
I can't remember the time that it was broadcast, but I know that you had to get home from school by running to catch it.
It came on just before the news, you know. Actually, wonderful spot. You know. This young man, Grange Calverley, had written a story about this dog, an actual dog that he had called Rhubarb, spelt with R-O-O. And he'd hawked it around every animation studio in London, and nobody wanted to touch it.
Oh, please go away, squeaked everyone.
He brought it round to me eventually. I think I was the last person he brought it to, and I looked at it and I thought, well, this looks like a bit of fun, you know, it looks good.
The oddest, doggiest character stood in the shed doorway, and then very slowly, he trundled out into the centre of the lawn.
This horrendously bright lime green dog just seemed so cool and so capable of doing everything.
He plunged towards the garden, and his big yellow spike plonked into the green turf. And even Custard, the big fat cat from next door, came to laugh.
The cat was very mean and really didn't have much time for anybody except himself.
Well, 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 if it's not the old dog himself sitting in a dustbin swinging from an earthquake-proof tree.
What's he doing there? It's terrible cat.
And tapped the dustbin hard enough to give poor old Rhubarb a headache for a fortnight.
But it's the balance between the idealistic, the doer, and the non-doer, you're the cynic, you know. He was totally cynical, that cat. He was really nasty.
Oh, plain chocolate money,
he groaned.
Haven't you any milk chocolate ones or ones with raspberry centres?
We had tremendous trouble getting a voice. So the BBC said, well, have you tried Richard Briers. I said, who's he, you know?
I've been out of work all winter and really do need a job.
OK, so we got Richard Briers, and he was perfect.
I'm a shadow, said the shape. Well, everyone's got one of those, explained Rhubarb. You'd have to be something else. But I'm a shadow boxer.
It just so happened that technology had introduced magic markers onto the market. So we started with these magic markers. Hey, these are good, aren't they? Yeah, great. Oh, dear, what a terrible smell. And then we hit on the magic wobble. There'd never, ever been a wobble before.
Clever, decided the bird. How do you do it?
Well, every drawing was done twice, so that there was a slight discrimination in the line. And it boiled, what we call boiled. Everything was on the move, and it gave it a tremendous energy.
Everything had been very classic and stylish before then. And suddenly here comes along this thing that was very psychedelic, very in your face.
I'd like Rhubarb to be a plate of jelly,
said the bluebird. So he was, and everyone wobbled him.
It was pretty revolutionary for its time, you know. Nobody had ever done that sort of thing before.
Remember?
Blazing Saddles.
At this studio, a film was made that is so shocking, it has caused people to faint, to become ill, to run screaming in terror.
And that was only the cast. No wonder they call it Blazing Saddles.
It caused a great sensation, a great stir. What vulgarity, what bad taste. And everyone loved it.
This is the story of the first black sheriff of Rock Ridge.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
You couldn't hear it. It was extraordinary, the waves of laughter, Gene Wilder particularly in there. People screaming with laughter at him.
The story of the brave men who rode past the pages of history.
Is anybody gonna die?
Love the big wait. Brilliant.
Oh! Oh! Ow! Have you ever seen such cruelty?
I wasn't in it originally. I wanted to play the Waco Kid, but Mel wanted someone else to play it then. He said, you're too young.
Dan Daly was first, and Dan, he could tip him up pretty good, man. Mel, after 4 or 5 days, invited him to go to the Betty Ford Hospital or somewhere.
So then they hired Gig Young. He came onto the set the first day and he started foaming at the mouth. He was drying out from drink. And that's when Mel said, call Gene now.
I don't know if you ever heard of me before, but I used to be called the Waco Kid.
The Waco Kid. He had the fastest hands in the West.
In the world.
Well, if you're the kid, then show me something.
Oh, well, maybe a couple of years ago I could have shown you something, but today, look at that.
Steady as a rock.
Yeah, but I shoot with this hand.
The first scene in the picture is, it tells you where that picture's going. No, it tells you we don't know where it's going because it is crazed, you know.
Now, come on, boys. Where's your spirit? I don't hear no singing. When you were slaves, you sang like birds.
I tell them, listen, I'd like you to sing a good old Afro-American work song. I did not say it exactly like that in the picture, you know.
Come on, how about a good old nigger work song?
I get no kick from champagne.
It's a satire of the West. It makes great statements about race relations and prejudice, bigotry.
Some get a kick from cocaine.
Hold it! What the hell is that shit?
People ask me all the time about, well, why have they not done a a sequel to the thing. And I'm sure Mel Brooks, it must have run through his mind, but I'll bet 3 years after they did the thing, the social climate of this country had changed so much that he probably just said, can't do that.
I got it!
So, what? We'll work up a number six on him.
Number six? I'm afraid I'm not familiar with that one.
Well, that's where we go riding into town. A whopping and a whomping. Every living thing that moves within an inch of its life. Except the women folks, of course.
You spare the women?
No, we rape the shit out of them at the number six dance later on.
It's just, it was outrageous then, it will be outrageous now. Unfortunately, in the 70s, it was also a huge breath of fresh air, which is an odd phrase to use when you're talking about Blazing Saddles, of course.
I'm thinking of the beans now. We're all eating the beans, sitting around eating the beans and all that.
Everybody would mention the beans. I won't say the F word.
Farting.
Farting.
Letting one go.
Blowing off.
That was sort of a first that you'd actually see and hear, fortunately not smell, but see and hear farting on film.
Mel Brooks says, I'm making you famous today. I said, why? He said, well, you read the script. I said, yeah, it's going to be kind of funny. He said, well, you're going to be the very first person in major motion picture history to do this. I did the very best I could do. Just carries on, you know, getting worse and worse. Or better and better, I don't know.
A fearsome noise from the rear end.
Remember the Ford Capri?
Can I say anything about the Ford Capri? No.
So I had one of them.
A friend of mine had one.
So I had a couple of them.
It was bright yellow.
Blue.
With silver.
Gold.
We named it Mary Poppins.
It emitted a fearsome noise from the rear end.
Fierce monster, it really was.
Still draws a crowd.
They just seemed to have bonnets that went on forever. And you were sat in the boot and you'd kind of be looking and still looking and never really ever seeing the end of the car.
They were kind of streamlined and sexy. There were a lot of those 50s and 60s British cars, you know, Hillman Imps and those Morrises that used to have like Tudor architecture on the back, you know, planks of wood. All those cars that said, this is a safe car, it's a reliable car. Nothing exciting will ever happen to you whilst driving this car. But the Ford Capri was kind of like, anything could happen.
I had a Capri once, which actually caught fire in Putney High Street. And I'm looking down at the steering wheel, and there's smoke and a small flame coming out of the centre of the steering column. The electrics in the steering column had suddenly gone haywire, and there I was stuck in the middle of Putney, and the traffic building up behind me, in my blazing car.
The new Ford Capri 2.8 injection. It goes like...
Capri Mark II came out in 1974, and it had a sort of sweet prescience about it because I had no idea of my future involvement with it.
Do you speak English?
I am English.
Oh.
And I was told that they were going to make an advertisement, and it was going to be the world's first three-minute commercial. Adrian Lyne was directing it, who went on to direct Fatal Attraction, amongst other things.
What's wrong?
Got something in my eye.
Oh, here, let me. Better?
Thanks very much.
Good.
Probably borderline pretentious, but it was a lot of fun to do.
I parked it in the roadway by the river and then went to the pub just across the road to have lunch upstairs. And I had forgotten totally, that this was the period of the peak spring tide. And this chap I'm having lunch with looks out the window and he said, I pity the owner of that Capri when he comes back. I said, Capri, that's mine. I said, what's wrong? He said, well, the water's already coming up through the doors. I could not get rid of the stench. I mean, it just smelt of the river. I had to sell it.
Capris are appalling. They are desperately bad. They've got a lot of power, but they can't put that power down on the road. And it handles like a perambulator, which is absolutely perfect, because if you take a corner at anything more than 25 miles an hour, it's going to screech and go sideways. You know, you saw us fighting the controls, but this is true, we were fighting the controls.
The Ford Capri was a kind of big deal at that time, and then became a sort of icon in itself, way out of tune with what it really was, and it developed as a semi-cult.
We are the Crappies.
I was crazy about Japan's people.
It wasn't breakdancing, but it was very athletic.
These girls could move, you know. They were wonderful.
Well, they're very sexy as well.
Pan is the god of dance and music and debauchery and darling, all those lovely things. You can understand why Dad's liked it, but Mum didn't object.
Some were very risque for their time, and some were very risque when I look back on it for these times.
I think 1974 was the moment when we kind of realised that how famous we were.
Pans people!
Pans people!
Pans people!
We had wonderful costumes.
I remember one costume particularly, which was a black dress. Sequins. I've always loved sequins and sparkles.
We did like it when we felt glamorous. You know, we went often in costumes that we really felt glamorous.
When will I see you again?
We did that particular number on the show, but what happened was later on we were asked to appear on Jimmy Savile's Clunk Click show.
Dear friends, Pans people, how about that? Here they are.
These dresses, they were slit right up to sort of our crutches.
I shall do the rest of this interview with my hands over my eyes, like this, and I shall be talking to these young ladies about their attributes.
You shouldn't sit down in them. It was a bad choice.
Louise, now then, apart from having to sit very still just now...
Yes.
Excuse me.
I'm trying very hard, actually.
We had toupee tape keeping us stuck all the way down the side to keep us in, because otherwise everything would have fallen out.
I did ask these young ladies, if they would come in, that we could see something of them, i.e. like to see the legs, because they wanted to come demurely dressed with all little sleeves down here and things like that, and I said no, because there's lots of gentlemen in hospitals and all sorts of places, and they, you know what I mean, they want to see them.
Mary Whitehouse, who was the campaigner against, you know, filth on television, she went completely ballistic. I think she had an apoplexy. She was so outraged. She said, how dare we wear these dresses? You know, when it was a children's programme. But there was nothing wrong with it. I mean, not as if it fell out. We just looked gorgeous.
Let's face the music and dance.
In 1974, we were at our height, I suppose. We did our own concert, which was, I think, the pinnacle of our career.
Dancer's dream come true. Louise and Dee Dee did a very raunchy little number.
All we did was kneel on these cushions and gyrate, just move this part of the body very slowly. And it was a very sexy number and very pretty. We wore almost next to nothing. We had sort of like just sort of suction pads here and a little tiny bikini, all embroidered, very beautiful. Most expensive costume we ever wore.
We all wanted to do that. Why couldn't I be chosen for that? I don't think every number worked as we perhaps had hoped.
There are smiles that make us happy.
We actually sang, oh my goodness.
Dancers, you know, should be seen and not heard.
Smiles that you gave to me.
And it was, well, I thought we were awful.
Oh dear.
All together now. There are smiles.
Girl group on television every week of the year, and of course the feminists went mad. They didn't like that at all. I have never felt exploited dancing on Top of the Pops, being with the stars. I mean, what young girl wouldn't want to do that?
For one all too brief period, incredibly brief period, I went out with one of them.
Did you ever go out with Martin Shaw?
No.
Martin Shaw? I wish, dear. He's gorgeous. No, I didn't.
Which one did you go out with?
I'm not telling you.
Oh, well, I better own up then, hadn't I?
The Wombles was brilliant. They used to clean up Wimbledon Common and go out their little bags that had big W's on them.
Wombles, start clearing up.
I've got confession to make about the Wombles. My mam made me a Wombles bag, and I used to go and collect all the litter in the street. It's not really, it's not too bad a confession to make, I suppose, as a 10-year-old kid, like, doing your bit and all that.
What were they exactly, the Wombles? Were they half bear, half... Or does that... Well, I guess that's not important.
Hey. I was asked, would I write the music for this series? And I said, well, why don't you have a song? Because a song could tell kids everything about the Wombles.
Oh, are you going to sing a song for
us? Oh, yeah, he's going to do his new signature tune. It's on record, you know, yeah? Terrific.
Underground, overground, wombling free.
And so the Wombles were transformed from animated characters in a children's programme into a pop phenomenon. They would go on to have 8 hits in the next 18 months.
Yeah, the wonderful Wombles of Wimbledon Common, wandering off the Common and through the Shepherd's Bush Theatre. There they go. Goodbye. Thanks for coming.
Get on with your cleaning up, Orinoco, you lazy Womble.
He used to eat too much and he slept a lot. And I sort of thought, oh, I'll be him. And I became Orinoco for the rest of my life.
Orinoco here, I don't think, could be in charge of anyone because he's very lazy and he's always falling asleep. And I also hear that he's very, very greedy.
I was in fact a Womble. It's quite conceivable that I would appear as Gris Bedding with 1 week on Top of the Pops and then the following week appear as Wellington. I think I seem to remember some comment in the teasers in the New Musical Express, some reference to me as the Leather Womble. Very voyeuristic, because you're this other entity, this Womble, but really inside you're this musician with all the sort of libido of a normal sort of rock musician, looking at these. You've got all these young teenage girls looking at you, you know, thinking this is a cute furry beast. I love you, Womble. But we were inside, peeking out through these little eye holes at these little teeny boppers with all these lavish thoughts.
A Womble costume is very hot.
And sweaty and uncomfortable.
You know, you just literally have sweat running into your face all the time.
Sticky and smelly, obviously from the previous occupant.
So we had to have a special hotel suite just to put the costumes in because they were so smelly. And you know, you'd think, well, why don't you wash them then? Well, we only had one set. It was stupid, it was just inexperience.
Oh, Womble, to your partners, young Wombles were told, if you minuet a Allegretto, you will live to be old.
My mother, she's now in her 70s. She's made every Womble costume, all the different characters. She's absolutely brilliant.
When the other Wombles were asleep at
The feet were the most difficult thing, really, I think, to make quite sure that they never, ever come off. Because there's nothing worse than losing a foot.
I desperately wanted to go to the loo, and in those days you used to have a... My mother had ingeniously put a beach ball in the front and a beach ball in the back, which you put in, and then you blew up to the desired amount of fatness. I'd got the costume halfway down around my knees, and these great big balls, if you see the expression, hanging out of my costume, and I was stuck. I couldn't get the angle, shall we say, the angle of dangle was wrong for me to relieve myself adequately without getting... all over the costume, you see, all over the balls and stuff. Oh, la, 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 hey, banana. Anyway, so we got these two truck drivers, and Jeff and I were trying to persuade, can you imagine the conversation? Well, you know, this is a womble, never heard of one, of course, because they weren't famous then. This is a womble, and this bloke is trying to have a wee, and he hasn't quite get the angle right, so could you hold his feet and just lift them up about 3 feet, and they literally lifted me and pointed me towards the urinal or urine, whatever you call it, and that's how we did it. And it was the most hilarious experience trying to get these guys to believe that we, you know, weren't sort of, I don't know, something other than what we claimed that we were.
Oh, very good, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, I bet you thought I was a real womble, didn't you?
So the Wombles were the biggest selling singles group of the year.
It's great stuff, really, you know, corny, but, you know, entertainment, and of course people are going to snipe at that, and people will snipe at anything that's successful.
It has been a slight cross to bear, you know, funny old Mike Batt that wrote the Wombles. But, you know, that is true, I was the man that did the Wombles, and I really am not ashamed of it at all.
Remember you're the Womble, remember you're the Womble. I'm not very good at this, actually.
Yes, but don't worry, Custard. We're doing 1975 next week.
Oh, no!